to my life, this is what I love, this is what the soundtrack to my life is made of, music, love, life.
Crystal Jordan, BS and myself, Kevin Davis, we are Music, Love, Life, and welcome to Wakanda. Yes. How is everyone?
I'm not doing that.
I am. Of course you will do it.
I am not doing it.
You will salute your king.
Happy Black Panther Week.
Hey.
This is the blackest I've ever seen social media.
Social media is
period
off the chain.
Do we need
right
to
now
tell people there's a spoiler alert ahead of time? Well, are we going to get into the details, or how do y'all want to approach this?
I want to go ahead and unpack some stuff.
I do think we should say spoiler alert. Spoiler yeah alert. Spoiler yeah alert. So if you have not seen definitely Black Panther,
come back
this
in a week
is not for yeah you. But we welcome you to come back and share your thoughts after you've been to Wakanda.
You can't actually go there. It's not a place.
You see the Instagram meme of the guy was like trying to book a flight to Wakanda.
Nope.
It's hilarious. He's like, yes, I'm trying to book a one-way ticket from Atlanta to Wakanda.
Well, you do know that a great portion of the film was filmed right here in Atlanta. So
yeah, but it doesn't look like it, though.
No. If you go into Wakanda, you're coming down 75 or 85.
And that does, this probably is the blackest place there is. So
hands down.
That makes sense. First of all, did everyone love the movie?
Yeah, I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it.
It was a good movie. I thought it was really great. I think that visually, I can only think of one other movie that even came close.
What would that
visually
be?
What was the movie with Leonardo DiCaprio?
Oh, yeah.
The Revenant.
The Revenant, yeah.
Is that
yeah,
the movie?
The Revenant.
Mm-hmm. That movie was beautiful.
Yeah.
This one was, if not equal, better.
It was total different types of movie,
right, but
though
still, though, as far as the way they use CGI and real
right
to make the lush landscapes and the way things look,
okay,
I thought that visually, though, you know, like, because in The Revenant, you remember, like, there was a scene where the bear attacked him. That looked pretty real.
That looked really real.
There was a scene where he was, like, I guess, hurt some kind of way, and he was breathing, and his breath and the blood got on the camera a little bit. Like, you never seen that in cinema.
Yeah.
So I think that, like, visually, these movies were both, like, very full, very dense and full of, like, a lot of creative ideas. So
I love the film, but I did think a couple of times, like, it just was like over the top CGI. Like,
did you see it in 3D?
I did. Okay. I saw it twice so far.
I didn't see it in 3D.
Okay.
How much was that?
That was the way to see it.
What?
In 3D.
Yeah.
So you could really pretend like you were really in a place.
You felt like you were there. Yeah, you felt like you were
reality
there.
It was coming at you.
I'm like, you know, when I was 7, that might have got me.
No, it just, no, I mean, it was a different experience, yeah.
Nah.
But the scene where he's like in the car, which was a dope, first of all, shout out to Lexus, great collaboration.
Like Tesla should have been that as far as like high-tech cars.
Yeah.
That should have been a Tesla thing.
I didn't think about that.
I ain't mad at Lexus, though. I love Lexus.
Tesla
probably dropped the ball on that. They should have
returned
that phone
call. Few people dropped the ball, but I mean, the scene where he's in the car and then the claws come out, and I was like, oh, wow, we're really cool.
Yeah, it was dope. I think that as far as the movie overall, though, because visually I think it's probably one of the best.
Yeah.
Movie overall, though, I'd say it's top 5 superhero movie.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Definitely. It has to be. And I'm not a real big superhero movie person.
Me either. Comic books either.
Yeah, like, I don't know the history. But so when I can go see a movie and understand what's happening without knowing the comic book history, I think that makes it a great movie. And you didn't need to know any of the prior history in order to really enjoy and really understand the plot and, you know, be able to relate to the character. So out the way.
I used to watch because they had a Black Panther cartoon that used to air on BET.
Right. And you've been putting those clips out, which is really cool.
Some of those episodes or the clips or whatever are on our social media. Mm-hmm. But
Black
I would
Panther
follow the cartoon and years ago. And so that had me hyped. Like, I had been waiting on this movie. And
Oh, yeah,
it didn't let me down. There are a few things that I wish that were in the cartoon that I wish were in the movie, but I'm not disappointed at all.
It was a really good film. It did, I mean, you know, the elephant in the room is there are obvious correlations between the issues going on with Black America and the film. all throughout, like so much symbolism, which I thought was really cool for them to be able to take a superhero movie and actually go back and show a different perspective. Like when they mentioned, okay, this happened, but Wakanda was kind of like the African country that didn't get touched by slavery. So you saw the little clips of this is what was happening in the outside world, and this is why we didn't have that situation here. So I thought that was very clever. And I just thought I thought Ryan Coogler, and I can't remember the other gentleman's name that co-wrote the film with him, did a great job of tackling and getting a message across without being preachy at all. It definitely fit, you know, the film. You saw what happens when a group of people, or in this case, one person, is disconnected from their history, disconnected from their past. That feeling of being disconnected is it has lasting, you know, effects. And we saw that with Michael B. Jordan's character, who did a great job, in my opinion. I've never, you know, he usually plays a hero. He played a great villain.
He's probably, Killmonger is probably my favorite new villain.
You didn't like him?
No, not personal. It's personal. My wife has really attracted him. And he came out of his shirt looking like a ribbed condom. You know what I'm saying? I was just like, nah, not feeling this dude no more. I'm sitting there looking at my wife like this in the movie theater like, really?
It's funny because I promise I did not make an audible sound when he took his shirt off. And my boyfriend was just like, and I was like, I didn't even say anything. Like, that's not even my fault. Like,
right.
You just assumed that I, you know, exhaled because right. It was such an amazing, magnificent display. But that's not my fault.
Knows woman. Mm-hmm.
No. Woman. I mean, I'm right. just saying, anybody would, any red-blooded female, red-blooded I mean, female. Jesus.
American.
Yeah. Anybody. Not gotcha. American. Red-blooded female. Doesn't have to be American.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm.
Be anything. You know?
Yeah, so it's personal. He did all right. That nigga did all right.
The beautiful thing about this, you
I'm
had a lot
get
of
mad at the beigest one in the film.
You should
Michael
been.
B. Jordan was the beigest one
he
in
was.
The film.
You should have been rooting him on.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It was some light skinned bald
chicks.
He
was your
chicks.
Guy. You should have been Boumaye Killmonger.
Nah.
Some light skinned bald headed chicks.
Honestly though, his character was the only one to me that was real. The rest of them were full of shit.
What?
Yeah, he was the good guy to me. Sad he died.
I can't be mad at you for that, though, right now.
Explain that. How is everybody else full of shit?
He's the one who was like, fuck all this system shit.
Right.
I've been on the side of the system that nobody wants to see.
Right.
Yeah, I'm coming back over here, and y'all got this fantasy land bullshit. He's like, nah, we burning all this. All, he, remember, he made him burn
he
all
burned,
the
because he like, didn't want another king to come. There's nobody else coming out keeping control of this shit.
He realizes that that's not real. The rest of the world is a different way than this one little small place. And once it got corrupted, it was never going back. So they need to keep that shit a secret.
I agree. I want them to keep it a secret. I didn't want King T'Challa to share with the outside world.
And he won the throne by right. Like, he won it. It was his.
Okay.
All the usurpers and stuff, like, they're, come on, you not loyal to your king.
Okay.
Michael B. Jordan.
Well, that was part of the Civil War. That was part of the Civil War within Wakanda, right? and then, matter of fact, you know you a bad motherfucker when you die and then go snap on the ancestors.
He snapped on the ancestors?
You were wrong. He snapped on the ancestors.
That was T'Challa, though. That wasn't Michael B. Jordan. No,
that's what's said. Yes.
Oh, okay.
He said he died.
I thought we were still talking about right. Michael B. Killmonger.
He did.
He had to. But my thing was, okay, they had to take away, and Kevin, you can explain this to me because I don't understand. Black Panther, was he a strong man? Because he almost lost both of his duels. And I was a little, he lost one of them. The other one he damn near lost. I think right. It was just like by chance that M'Baku wasn't able to beat him up. I wanted him to keep the strength of the Panther. I was afraid every time because he's very small compared to the challengers. And I'm just a little concerned about, are we going to have to go through this every time someone challenges him?
Every year. Like,
every time someone, because he's a very small man.
Well, you know what? I will say in those particular, in those two duels, mm-hmm. he had to have the strength of the Black Panther. Remember they gave him that elixir.
They took it away from him.
So
I don't want him to strip it the next time.
Like super soldier powers away from it, or the powers of the herb. That was actually a gem that I thought was.
Wait a minute. Answer my question though, Kevin. In the comedy, is he strong or what is his thing? Like, is it just a regular feeble man?
Yes, he's a regular. So it's that what is the name of it?
Vibranium.
Vibranium. That is what makes him strong.
Why come M'Baku and the other guy are just naturally strong? Maybe need to get another.
He took the elixir to make him regular strength again.
Right.
To fight them, because the strongest man has to be the person who gets the vibranium.
Well, I understand that, but I'm just saying. Well, chances are his next challenger is going to be bigger than him.
I agree.
Him,
he really
we're going to have to go through this again.
He's not supposed to be there right now, right? As we speak right now, Michael B. Jordan.
Yeah, the reason he was there was because his father was killed. He was thrust into that.
So really, he isn't supposed to be king.
Nope. Two reasons why. That's two reasons. Two good reasons why.
You know what? You're right, because he went back and fought Michael B. Jordan, but he had the strength of the Black Panther that time.
Right.
So really, he's not really Michael B. Jordan is still king.
Supposed to be.
We have just worked out the sequel.
No, he's dead.
If somebody has another one of those blooms.
Nah, Killmonger is gone now.
No, yeah,
he remember said I'd rather be this than be a slave.
But they're telling you Black Panther was dead, and Baku's fisherman pulled him up.
That was a hard ass line too. Let me go. Just bury me in the ocean.
That sounds good.
No, niggas. Yo. Niggas are not dying over being slaves. Obviously. Obviously.
I mean, I don't think they knew exactly what was going to happen, but it sounds good. It sounds very, it's a romantic
thing. They had a chance every day to be dead.
No, they didn't. They couldn't jump off. They was chained by their necks.
No. Once they got where they was going, they had a chance every day to be dead. They chose to keep on living.
Incorrect
they
show.
Keep on living.
Because bondage.
Because they rather have those couple of giggles at night when they're not working. They rather have that than be dead.
I mean, I can't even front.
You're okay right now.
It's not even
changes.
That. Okay, stop.
You're picking cotton today.
But you know what? It wasn't.
Who's not
even
picking
that.
Cotton at this table? Raise your hand.
It wasn't that. It was the idea that you were working towards believing that one day you were going to be able to be free. There was hope.
When? In what year? 1860 what? 1850 who?
Oh, God.
Look, Harriet Tubman.
1690 what?
Harriet Tubman and the Underground Railroad. Everybody was working towards getting us out of that situation. So I believe those people really went to sleep believing that there was a change was going to come. I don't think they just.
Nat Turner said, you know what? Hey, y'all, let's gather around.
After he was being a pawn, used as a pawn for the white slave master. It took him a while to come to his awakening.
I mean,
don't act like he was woke from the beginning.
In terms of, I don't know if I even want to explain, but in terms of it being in captivity, there is a sense of normalcy, right? You know, you got to do what you got to do. Even today, we all know that we got to do some things that we don't want to do. Right, in order to make it through, or to get further along, right? We're gonna get through this. I'm just going in here, and we gonna.
But I think everybody has that, though. That's not just African Americans.
Oh my God, hey. You're not racist? I could have sworn you were racist.
I just had to catch it up to my modern day, but you know that's.
I just have an old man accent though.
I told ever since I've been to Wakanda, I speak with a different accent now.
Oh, I noticed that you wrote an article with the haste.
I did. I had to right after I saw the premiere. So I think that the movie had a lot of lessons for Black America. I do think that Killmonger was a painful reflection. That article is coming out tomorrow on rollingout.com. But I think that it was a really clever way of showing some of the inter-community issues that we have. So you have some people who believe that, you know, I don't care about the rest of the people. I'm just going to, you know, get money for myself and my family. And if I have to sell drugs to do that, and if I have to gangbang to do that, I don't care. And then you have some other people
who was the person?
No, not in the movie. I'm saying Killmonger's attitude is a reflection of what's going on to me in the Black community and what has gone on. And all of that is a reflection of what happens when you have a group of people who are disconnected from their heritage.
Can we stop right there though before we move to the next point? Mm-hmm. Like, get down with your point on number one before we move to number two.
Right. No. I think that's the overall point. Okay. That's my collective point, is that all the problems that we have, one of the things, the biggest message in the movie to me was that there was a way for T'Challa to, he was connected to where he came from. You know what I mean? He, his father, there was traditions passed down. Not all of them were right, but they had a sense of who they were. They were on a firm foundation because they knew where they came from. And this is the way we do things, and this is who we are. Where Killmonger had no clue where he came, you know, he knew what his father had gone through, but he had never been there. And so he adopted the principles of
the American way.
To the American way, and he did all that under an ignorance of this is how to do things to get ahead. But he was totally lost. And there's a scene where he goes back after he becomes king and talks to his father, and you see him as that lost little boy. And to me, that just looked like Black America.
Absolutely. I mean, and they actually made a point to say that Killmonger had been trained by the American troops, and he had learned the American way.
Right.
He learned the murder,
right.
kill, eat what you kill, go for yours. That type of mentality, and so he embodied that.
Right.
But he still had a heart for what others were going through in the slums and not being able to defend themselves.
He was angry, though.
He was the only one. T'Challa was a dickhead.
How you figure that?
I promise you.
How was he a dickhead?
I'm gonna tell you how. He's a fucking trillionaire. He has no care for any of the regular people. Name one regular person you saw in this movie.
Well, he had a care for his people.
No, he didn't.
His responsibility as king was to take care of his
Show me
people,
one which, happy regular folk. All we saw was kings and generals and goddesses and motherfucking soothsayers.
Well, that's because that was the movie. But he kept saying
there
that
is
I'm,
no community.
I'm responsible
there is no
for
community
Wakanda.
Where a trillionaire
it was an entire
is a,
country.
I know, but there is no community, country, whatever, where there's a trillionaire. There's the 1%. I need to see the motherfuckers in the ghetto because there's a ghetto in Zamunda. I mean,
Wakanda.
There's no ghetto.
There's
Wakanda.
Definitely
they
a ghetto.
They have technology.
No.
There definitely is a ghetto in Wakanda.
The ghetto is the because they were saying that Wakanda is a third world country, which I didn't even.
No, that's what the Americans
were
saying.
I don't know what the
saying.
Term third
that's
world
what,
really.
That's what the Americans were saying.
To be, but that's a different conversation.
Cool way
there were
of
two,
saying
there
you're
were two
uncivilized.
People.
Right.
There were only two real people in the whole movie.
Okay.
Nakia and Killmonger. That's it. The rest of them were on their high horses, living the trillionaire life, or living by the trillionaire, the man sitting next to the man. I promise you, there were only two real people. The rest of these people were dickheads.
Well, that's
they were
part
rich,
of what,
spoiled
brats.
That
was part brats. Of what T'Challa's epiphany was, is that that's why he went and snapped on the ancestors. Y'all were
I don't
wrong.
Know about snapping,
you shouldn't have left him behind.
Right.
You shouldn't have left him behind because you created this.
He only had to get his ass kicked to understand that.
Well, that's part
well,
of what
know.
Black Americans and Native Africans have to deal with is the fact that, like, I've been told that Africans don't like us.
Mm-hmm.
I've been told that before.
But that's
I don't
bullshit
know that
too.
That's true, but that's
of
what
course
I've been
well,
told.
I do think that there are bad relations between Africans and African Americans, but a lot of that is because African Americans have been taught to reject their history. And so
in the name, we're rejecting in the name. African American, continent American, America's a country. Africa's a continent American.
That's
that doesn't
true.
Make any sense.
Well, and you know what, to be honest with you, if you're black and you're born in America, you probably shouldn't be calling yourself African American.
I don't.
But
what are you?
Because if you came from Asia and you live here now, you're an Asian American.
Right.
But if you came from Africa and you live here now, you're an African American.
Right.
We should be Black American at best.
That's
but
it.
American.
Yeah, American, right. That's what I am.
Right. But what we actually were we were kidnapped. We were kidnapped.
I wasn't kidnapped. You were kidnapped?
Somebody in your bloodline was kidnapped.
Are you sure?
And brought here.
You're positive?
Are you half black?
No, but you think everybody
that's
black
all I need
is
to
kidnapped?
Know. Are you? Does someone who looked like me are they in your bloodline somewhere?
Yeah, but I'm
you
not
got
sure.
A grandpa, some grandma
my dad,
somewhere.
My dad is darker than you, but I'm not sure that he was kidnapped.
If you go over here, he was kidnapped.
Really? That seems a little short-sighted.
Short-sighted?
A little bit.
Do you really think...
Short-sighted?
Do you think Africans were willingly walking onto the boat?
Well, we know that's not true.
No, but that's not how every black person got to America.
That's true. But there are always going to be outliers.
Black folks walk everywhere.
This is true.
That's how the world was
this
populated.
This is true. There were black people here before Columbus.
True.
Absolutely.
But Asia... Yeah. Europe.
India.
You know what I'm saying? Like, so everybody black here was not a slave or from descendants of slaves.
A large majority of us are.
I'd be willing to bet that the majority are. Right. But that doesn't mean that all of us are. And I think that you were right when you said Americans. I mean, at some point, we have to create lineage. We keep talking about we're trapped, we're cut off. Well, when do we stop and say, okay, well, now, today is the day that
we
start.
But the problem with that is America's history is one, like we said, of okay, we're going to take this from them, take that from them. There really is no culture.
That's everyone's culture. Everyone took something from someone. That's how you have to, in order to grow, you have to move.
I'm talking about as far as in Africa and other cultures. I don't know a lot of information about it, but what I do know is there are religious, I mean, there's history. There's a rich culture of this is where we came from. These are our traditions. And right. And that's not here in America, period.
Got to start though. It started there. Something.
But
in Black America, this is the first time in the world that we made our own culture. When we were cut off from our native traditions and we started with blues and hip hop and that type of shit.
That's not true, Kevin.
Every culture started making our culture.
Every culture was made at some point. If you believe in the deluge or whatever, Noah's Ark story, the world was depopulated and it had to begin again.
Right.
That kind of thing happens in certain pockets where
nowhere else in the world were you actually penalized if you practiced your native beliefs.
I don't know if that's true.
You spoke your native tongue.
Oh, are you kidding? Come on,
nowhere
man.
Else
the Arab
in
countries
the world.
Are very brutal when it comes to other people's beliefs.
No other slavery was as brutal as American slavery.
The Ottoman Empire, like the
I
Muslim,
don't know. I don't know.
They conquered it.
No other one.
Kevin, that's just not true, man. That's just not factual.
Bring your receipts.
Well, I don't want to trivialize the discussion because I think there's truth on both sides. I definitely don't think that it was the most brutal. I think that's what we know about and that's what we're concerned about because it affects us.
It's personal.
But yeah, it's personal. But I don't believe that because there's other countries where there's some really messed up
for
like
women
ridiculous.
Still right now today
right.
Not even
yeah.
400 years ago
it's
talking about right
absolutely
now
absolutely out of control and there's not the moral compass that we kind of have like oh this is too far no it's not anything really too far you know which I guess with slavery it wasn't but the point
I wanna
is
I
want
to get to your the 4 points here because I thought right. they were pretty good
so okay so there's the point of the disconnection but the first point that I actually made in the article was that the king when T'Challa went back to greet his father, he said, "Do not kneel, you know, raise your head, you're a king." And I thought that, I think a lot of times we bring with us, I have a friend of mine that has a son who I think his son is 8 now. He said, "I never let my son watch slavery movies. I never let him watch pictures of people that look like him in chains because I always want him to remember that he is a king and I don't want him to feel the shame that is connected with that." And I can remember being in school in Tulsa, Oklahoma, where there was a really big race riot that happened, the 1921 race riots in Tulsa, mm-hmm. and feeling a shame when I watched that. And I think that a lot of times Black America takes that, we take that idea with us that we're still, oh, they don't, you know, the white man's going to treat us this way. And you bring that before it's even done to you because there's a history of shame and humiliation. And you see police, you know, putting water and dogs on people that look like you. And it's something that makes you think of yourself in that way. And I think that's very, very detrimental to the psyche of, I remember being a small kid and thinking, oh my God, is that what they did to us? Yeah. So I think the idea I don't know about him, you know, he got a lot of flack for saying, "I never allow my son to watch that," but I understand why. And I think that was a good point in the movie that you have to always stand upright. And it's kind of hard to teach a child to always remember you're a king when you see constantly, not just dogs being led on people in the 60s, but now police killing people in plain daylight. So how do we still remember that there's a royal blood within you? You know what I mean? If you're constantly reliving those images over and over and over again. You know what I mean?
I really wanted to debate this topic. I was hoping this wasn't first. I see the danger in that mm-hmm. statement. I feel like that is very dangerous because the same way that today's young people are not really associating themselves with the struggle is the reason why they're kind of living in this Wakanda type life where there is everybody's a king, everybody gets a trophy, everybody. But honestly, like I was saying, T'Challa and them, that those few people on that mountain, that was it. The rest of the people, you never even knew their names, you never saw them. They're not kings. They're not descendants of kings. They're not tied to kings other than they're ruled by one. And the majority of people are not kings. They're not royal bloodline. And I think that it's very dangerous to pretend that every kid should stand up because he's a king. No, you need to know how fucked up it is, because if you don't, you're going to fool yourself into thinking that you're a king, and you're going to start just asking for entitlement shit, and you're never going to actually work and say, reality is, these motherfuckers treat us awful. And I see these chains, I'm not going to be in chains. If you believe that there's something else there, it's like, maybe I'm a little more comfortable. Maybe it's not so bad. I'll be a little more comfortable. You know what I'm saying? I think that sometimes you need that reality. You need that. You need though to see those chains to make you angry, to fuel the will and the need to get out of that situation and never return to it. I would be fooled. I feel like you might be fooled otherwise.
I agree with you, and I disagree with you on different parts of what you said. I do think that there's something to the there's something to knowing the reality of the world around you, right? And preparing yourself for it in order to succeed, to meet the challenge, right? And I think a lot of, so I agree with you on that token, but I think a lot of people have kind of struggled with that idea, or I've heard different debates on social media where, you know, we didn't all come from kings. We couldn't have all been kings, right? But, and in what the movie touched on was a piece of knowledge that not everybody necessarily has. For instance, in the Bible, it says that we've come from 13 tribes, right? But in the movie, they said five. The five tribes form Wakanda. They said it was based on, and it was because of the vibranium that was in the soil. But in Africa, we know it wasn't actually vibranium. It was gold. It was diamonds. It was all of the other resources that they have that actually makes the country really like the source of everything, right? But in terms of coming from kings, those 13 tribes, each of those tribes had kings.
Had a king.
And so if you were one of them, if you were come from that bloodline, there's at least 13 of them. Right?
That's still one person, though. One king out of each tribe. And one family that would be... I agree with both of you. I see what you're saying. Statement sounds a lot like the Chris Rock special where he was like, I tell my daughters every day, no one gives a fuck about you when you leave this house. And I think there's something to be said for that. But I also think that you have to have a balance. And I think that a lot of Black America walks around with this chip on their shoulder that it's an imaginary chip. You know what I mean? It's not, it's some of the stuff that is happening to us and then some of the stuff that you think is happening and it works against you. You know what I mean? And your mind is the best place to overcome anything. So I don't know.
And you're right. I think there should be a balance. You do need to be aware of what's going on in the world outside of you. But if that's all you see, if that's all you see is people putting you down, then you're going to do it for them.
Exactly.
Right.
I agree.
But if you're thinking that no one can touch you because you're this and you're all that, then you've also got a false reality.
But I don't think it's that. I think that saying keep your head up, I think keep your head up, to me that says to hold yourself, you have to see yourself in a certain light. Yes. Other people may not see you that way. Killmonger did not see T'Challa as his king. He actually neither did M'Baku. He was like, your king is weak. But I think that there's something to be said for you instilling something in your children and in your, you know, those that look to you, that lets them know that no matter what's happening around you, you hold yourself to a higher standard. Yes, that may not be what happens, you know, around you. And, you know, you can hold yourself in that regard at any place in life. You could be a waitress, but carry yourself with a certain dignity because you know who you are, right? I think that's the message. I do think it's dangerous that we've taught millennials that there doesn't have to be work. They don't have to hold them. I can just do what I want because I can post a picture on Instagram. I think that's very dangerous. Not so. I agree with what you're saying. There's no sense of hard work equaling success. It's just, I want success. I'm entitled to it. No.
And you're a king. I think really the rugged truth of it all is that, majority, and like we've talked about this before, about the way that I think like the bank account of most black people in this country is just doesn't permit you the luxury, freedom. The freedom, the luxuries of relaxing. Mm-hmm. And to me, when I hear somebody say you're a king, I'm like, man, you better, if you're a king right now, shit, what is it like if you really work for this? You know what I'm saying? Right. And that's why I guess I take the king thing personally, because to me, a king doesn't have to, you know what I'm saying? That's like you're royal. Like you get to just coast through
my
life.
My son works.
Because I think that we as adults, you know, as mature adults, we understand that the symbolism behind king. But these younger people,
they just look at it as
they hear king and they're like, I'm royalty. You can't talk to me that way.
That's true. Right. But it's that's not true. Like just because you're and I think we got to see some of that in Black Panther as well. Just because you're a king doesn't mean that you just get to sit back on your throne of luxury.
In fact, your responsibility is higher than
those
around
you. It's much greater, right? It's just like being in love or whatever. Like just because you're in a relationship doesn't mean it's going to be all rose petals and fine dining. You know, you actually got to go through some stuff.
Heavy is the head.
Exactly. Yeah. Well,
to now, whom much is given, much is required.
Now, the next point,
you know
I don't think that
we both had to say. You don't have one?
No, I have nothing. Especially we threw a relationship in there. I'm totally out. But it does bring me to the next point, which I don't think that even Beyonce will be able to disagree with. But I will give you the opportunity to try.
Sure.
Oh, he will disagree.
I know. But it's going to be rough because I felt like this movie, again, brilliant on behalf of the writers, showed the fact that men and women, in this case, black women and black women, working together are powerful, right? I think that, you know, we've seen the whole year, 2017, going to 2018, of people, you know, hashtagging relationship goals and black love and things like that. But to me, this movie showed the best, I guess, examples of that, because we saw how T'Challa was strong, but he was nothing without the Dora Milaje behind him. You just saw black men and black women working together to for a common goal without all the issues that we usually see. And there was a great line that Nakia said to him. She said, you know, T'Challa's trying to convince her to be his queen in a very subtle way. And he says, you know, if you weren't so stubborn, you would make a great queen. And she said, I would make a great queen because I'm so stubborn. And I just felt like, for every alpha female who's ever been told that she's too strong, you know, this is just validation that actually a strong woman is what a strong man absolutely needs.
I don't know if it's validation. You know?
I think it's validation.
This is a story. It's a fantasy story. It's a good line.
It's a great line.
I happen to agree with you. I think that you don't actually know me. Chris, I thought we've been friends for a long time. I am totally for group economics. I am totally for everybody getting together and figuring this shit out as a group.
Right.
Because we together obviously can do more good than just one or two of us scattered around the world. I mean, our podcast network, we do that as a group. Right. Anytime we have dudes, we do it together.
Right.
We all understand that it takes all of us, the little pieces that we do here, bringing a guest on, or, you know what I'm saying, social media, all of that together is what makes it happen. So, you're not going to get any arguments from me on that. I don't know about the stubborn, but I can say that Nakia is beautiful.
Well, he didn't say it. He did not agree with her. He just was like,
not that stubborn shit. I'm talking about she's a beautiful woman.
We know she's gorgeous,
but we don't get a lot of that. So it's important to say it.
That's true.
We don't get a lot of that. We don't get a lot of the opportunity for people to put, you know, women of her color in a lead role.
And she's absolutely gorgeous.
It was wonderful seeing my sisters as scientists and warriors, mm-hmm. like, and still regal. Like,
yeah.
That shit was dope.
Just bad as hell.
Very beautiful and all of that.
Did they do CGI on Forrest Whitaker's eye? Because he looked like his eye wasn't bad.
No, I think he got his eye fixed.
No, it was still bad.
In Wakanda.
And the guy that played it.
Nah, man, you got Hey, if they brought the other dude back to life, man, with the vibranium, then they should fix Forrest Whitaker.
Forrest Whitaker, I was looking straight ahead. It's never it hasn't looked straight ahead since like 19.
Social media picked that up.
I saw social media said that on a poster.
It's a meme.
But in the movie, it was still bad. And then actually, the character that played him as a young guy had a bad eye too.
Yeah, he was a little lazy.
They made it true to life. Yeah. But you know what I thought was interesting? I don't know if you guys picked this up. So Nakia was loyal to T'Challa because she loved him, right? Mm-hmm. But then what is the guy's character, Daniel, that played
Get Out?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what was his character's name?
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I don't remember right now.
Score for us. I thought Kevin would know. So his wife, who is the general, when they were at odds, and because he picked the side of Killmonger at the, you know, towards the end.
He didn't pick the side of Killmonger.
He did.
He picked the side of his king.
Of his rightful king.
He didn't betray.
Because he was upset with T'Challa.
He did
because
he was mad about Claw.
Yeah, he was mad about Claw.
He was like, oh, you let Claw
because
slip?
Because his parents were killed by Claw.
Right. He's the king.
But no. So his love, we don't know if it was his wife or his love, but we knew they were together because she called him my love. And he said, you would kill me, my love. And she said, for Wakanda, without a doubt. And I was like, wow. So because he's not king, his chick will betray him, but Nakia would not betray T'Challa. So I wonder, she was going to kill him. She did not give a damn.
And you know what? That kind of proves something to me, too.
A rich man gets the women?
Well, not only that. Well, he was rich, too. I mean, dude.
He wasn't as rich as T'Challa.
Yo, dude had a blinged out rhino. How you pull up on a rhino?
He wasn't the king, though.
How you pull up on a rhino?
The richest man always wins. Yeah, but the richest man always wins.
Nonetheless.
Just kidding.
Nonetheless.
Don't send no damn email to me about
that. What I feel like the woman's lesson was in that is that she figured out when to be stubborn. Sometimes y'all can be stubborn and it works for you.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you're stubborn and it don't work for you.
She was going to kill him.
But
she was.
No, she was going to try to kill him.
She was the best fighter they had. She was going to kill him.
He immediately stepped down.
He kneeled. You know what? He kneeled. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, you all know when to say when, damn it.
He didn't want to kill his wife. That's why he stopped.
Well,
no, but she knew too.
She's going to take his head off.
She knew too.
She's going to take his head off. I was going to enjoy watching that.
She knew too because she saw her country in peril.
She didn't.
It was at that point, it was civil war, especially when T'Challa came back, when the bird crashed and he emerged from the ashes.
Yes, he did.
Y'all catch that? And he was died in the water and was reborn. I don't know if y'all caught
it. Yeah, we all caught it.
Blowing the horn.
Yeah.
Yo, it was some very
overt symbolism, right?
Yeah.
It was not hidden at all.
Hey. So a fantasy movie written off of another fantasy story. Very supernatural.
So we all agree about black women and black men fighting together.
Oh, yeah.
You all need us.
But listen, I'm just saying, man, y'all be doing too much sometimes.
Nobody was doing too much in the movie.
Hey, look, we better together. That's all I'm saying.
And kneel. Okay? All right? kneel down.
How are you going to end the segment with that? Go to the next one, man. Goodness gracious.
Nope. Okay, so we have... So, the last point, and I think... I know, be honest, and I've talked about this a lot over the last few years in the industry, so I'm interested to see how you relate to this point. There was a passage in there where his father... T'Chaka was talking to his son before, when he first, you know, was crowned king. And he said, I want to be a good king. And he says, you're a good man. Hmm. And it's hard for a good man to be king. And I love that because he would basically, if T'Challa had the heart of Killmonger, which was pretty much, I don't give a damn about anybody but myself, it would have been a lot easier for him to make decisions. A lot of his decisions were made based on the people he cared about and the people he felt responsible for. And so he wasn't able to be greedy. He wasn't able to have his own agenda because he was always thinking about the greater good. Even when his friend was like, bring back Claw because, you know, my parents were killed by him. I know he wanted to do that, but his first, I guess, responsibility he felt to his people, which kind of crippled him from being able to be more successful on his own. And so there was a point made that is, it is hard for a good man to be king. And I think if we even look at what's going on in our country right now, it was a lot easier for someone who had their own agenda to become president, you know, but for someone who actually is looking out for other people, a lot of times it's difficult if you have an agenda that is not your own, you know, it's not run by money. You know, if you're a greedy capitalist, is people see that as winning. People see that as successful. But when you're actually trying to make a difference, it's a lot harder when you actually have, you know, a purpose and you're ruled by passion as opposed to money and greed, it can be a lot more difficult. So I actually applauded them for putting that in there. I don't know if a lot of people picked up on that or even thought about what that meant.
Yeah.
But every time we saw T'Challa make a decision, it was not, you know, based on himself. It really was on what he felt was the right thing. Even when he went back and said, you were wrong for doing this, his father didn't have that same moral compass, I guess, because he was able to leave his nephew to kill his brother and leave his nephew behind, where T'Challa would never have made that decision because he was a good man. So I think that was a really strong point.
So who wins, though?
Unfortunately.
How long does T'Challa keep that bullshit up?
Well, you know what? I feel like Killmonger would have been a great king in wartime, right? Like, Killmonger is a great war general, but in peacetime...
Is he?
T'Challa would have been a better king.
I disagree. I don't think you can have anyone who ever is that way. He would have won, but at what expense?
Well, I do think, well, just based on what the movie showcased, I think, like, there are definitely some times where T'Challa was too nice, right? And that allowed him to be vulnerable because of, you know, he was showing mercy, right?
It felt like
but you know what? Even after Killmonger was killed, he still went back to Oakland, where the story started, right? And said, "Hey, I bought this building. I bought that building. We're going to start to open up. I can't allow Wakanda to continue in its old state. We're going to do something new now."
That's very peaceful. It's children coming and learning. It's not kill you either with us or against us. Give us our money. Like, it's not the same thing at all.
Like, let's be real. As much as I can appreciate what Killmonger was trying to do, once those powers were overthrown, then what?
He was going to make it all for himself.
He had no long-term plan.
He had a long-term plan. That's why he burned them leaves. He was a dictatorship.
He won fair and square. He won fair and square.
But the point is, he was going to make it a dictatorship. He didn't care about his people.
The challenge wasn't over.
I don't know that he didn't care about
his people. That was covered in the film. The challenge wasn't over.
It was over because he was dead.
Yeah, he was gone.
They brought him back to life.
The nigga was on ice.
So really, he was dead. The challenge was over. I'm just concerned about what's going to happen at the next challenge, because T'Challa's not good at these challenges. I'm concerned about Chadwick's. Maybe he could beef up a little more or something, because seriously, the next time someone challenges him, it's going to happen again if they take away those powers. Is anyone concerned about that?
I thought he was not the king. I think he's no longer the king. I'm still mad about that.
I'm just saying, M'Baku is one, he was one hit away from being the king.
And I mean,
are you done?
And you know what's funny? What's funny though is that we were talking about, you know, how great T'Challa was or whatever, but there was a whole group of people that were kind of, that ended up exiling themselves.
Yeah.
So there had to be something that wasn't all the way right.
Well, he did that because he said, if you notice, M'Baku said, you, in 30 years, no king has come here.
Right.
So T'Challa's father was not the king that T'Challa is, because, and he said, well, I want to change that.
No, he came there because he died. That's why he came there.
But he didn't kill M'Baku like his father probably would have done. His father definitely would have killed him. At the point that he said, at the point that he did not, T'Challa ignored the 48 laws of power, right? So that's another example of a good man is hard to be king. Because the point that he could have killed M'Baku, he said, your community needs you. Your people need you. I don't want to kill you. Don't make me kill you. Your people need you.
That was why he didn't kill Claw.
So
the world is watching.
So exactly. He chose the good guy, but that ended up working to his favor later because M'Baku saved him. But that's the point. The idea of kill my enemy at any means necessary. He doesn't have that mentality, which leaves him vulnerable. And, you know, it's a superhero that most people really would not applaud. It's just the way the movie is. I really, I think Beyonce is right. I don't know if he's really king.
I don't think he is. I mean, I don't know. But hey, that's all I got on Black Panther. You guys got anything else? Number three, best superhero movie of all time? Probably number three. I say number three.
I mean, I'm going to say number one because I don't really.
I can't. I wanted to.
Who's number one?
I went with Open Slate. I promise I did. But I full disclaimer, I've never been a comic book person like you. I was more interested in pussy. I know there's some people really delved really deep into this and they know all the world and backstory. Not you, Kevin.
I didn't know
not
how talking those about two you. Even are next to each other.
No,
is everything
you couldn't
next
do both.
To it? Really?
Not when I was growing up. You couldn't have Spider-Man number one and get pussy. You bring a girl to your house and she's like, oh my God, look at the figurines. It's over. It's over. It's over. Now, I know the people,
pretty accurate,
the homies
actually.
In New York and LA, they were like comic book people and they're cool guys. But in Atlanta, mm-mm.
Oh, okay.
Socialization made a choice for me. Okay. So that being said, I think that The Dark Knight and The Dark Knight Rises are actually much better movies overall than
what about the Avengers?
Black Panther. I think Iron Man is pretty good, but my surprise, my sleeper is Hancock. I thought Hancock was actually a pretty good superhero
movie. I don't
even
know what that is.
With Will Smith.
Yeah.
You never seen that? You got to see Hancock.
Hancock was great.
So I'm putting Black Panther at number three only because Dark Knight and Dark Knight Rises are probably two of the best movies ever
now,
of all movies.
What Batman is that in those?
That is Christian Bale.
Okay.
So that's not that old cartoon Batman. This is like that real dark, gritty shit.
Yeah. And is that the one with the Heath Ledger?
Heath Ledger was a Joker in Dark Knight. And then Tom Hardy was Bane in Dark Knight Rises.
I didn't like that. That really, he was out of control.
That was a bad villain. Those movies were
heavy. Oh my God, he was evil.
Yes.
He was too evil.
That was a good
and
ass
I didn't
movie.
Like him.
It was,
I didn't
right?
like him. But see, the thing about it, like the thing I like about Black Panther is, okay, Killmonger was a villain. I like a villain that I can empathize with. Bane, what the hell was that?
Yeah, Bane grew up in that pit. Remember he had to climb out of it? You can relate to that?
Yeah.
You can relate to that, right?
Yeah. I couldn't relate to it.
Yo, and when he touched that dude and said, do you feel in control? Man, so that's saying a lot because Black Panther's right under ethos.
Yeah.
So
it's
hard to beat those two. But
well, I'm high on Black Panther right now, and I think the rest of the world is right now. Like, I've never seen my timeline this black. I've never seen so many people.
I don't know white America is excited.
But I think people thought that dressing up in African garb.
Yes.
I thought that was a joke. No, that was for real.
Did you dress up?
I didn't dress up this time.
Okay.
I didn't dress up this
time.
Well,
you really missed out because going later is going to be kind of weird.
I had hired rose bearers. I was finna do the thing.
Oh, my God, Kevin.
I did walk on.
In fact, if you go to my Instagram, at Enchanted PR, walk on rose petals walking into Wakanda.
My black people. I know you don't think they're mine, but they're my black people, too.
We are exceptional people. We go above beyond.
Have you been to Comic-Con? Have you been to a comic? People go crazy about stuff.
And those people don't get pussy. That's why this is odd to me. Like, they're lame if you dress
up. Girls do it.
If you dress up like R2-D2 and go to see Star Wars,
you're lame
as fuck.
I'm not dealing with a guy that does that. That's
girls do
That's what I'm trying to get y'all to understand.
I get it.
People are like, well, we don't say nothing when they go to Lord of the Rings all dress up. I do. I'm like, what the fuck is wrong with y'all? What the fuck? No, nigga, you are not Jabba the Hutt.
At Patriots game.
You don't go LARPing?
I don't even know what that means.
The live action role play?
Wow, no.
You don't remember?
That was awkward.
No,
I don't know what that means.
What movie was that where they were?
Acronyms. No. I never knew that one.
No. There is a guy that I'm rolling out. Shouts out to Mo Barnes that's really into that stuff. I don't know.
I thought that all the extras, you know, fun, but still a little corny.
You ever been downtown Atlanta and seen all them people dressed up like Star Troopers?
Some of them spend a lot of money, too.
No, but they scare me. I'm afraid of those. I'm afraid of all that. But I wore an African print dress that I had worn before to an event. But
aww.
I did. But, you know, I think it's...
I feel
it's
like
hype.
This one, well, Star Wars doesn't necessarily have any cultural significance. Black Panther has every bit of cultural significance.
I think Star Wars has cultural significance to people. I mean, this was just black cultural significance.
Now, nobody's an Ewok.
No, there was an Ewok, but there's a Star Wars has. I mean, it's a cult movie. Like people love it. People, they create
people who know those languages.
It's a cult movie, like, but it's not a culture.
Gotcha.
With an actual land and people.
But neither is Black Panther because it's all made up.
Yeah.
That's all fantasy.
Black person.
Wakanda does not exist.
It's in a real continent.
I know you said three times I've been to Wakanda. The shit don't exist.
Hey, look, I grew up on Coming to America, so I've been to Zamunda about 38 times, okay?
I don't want to negate. I mean, I think it's cool that we're getting excited about it, but
White people are in a cut like, whoo, they're worse than us at this.
They are. I mean, if I was a white person, I would totally be like, they're really taking this a little bit too far.
Yeah.
Like, enough
but,
already.
But fun, though. Yeah. I still think it's got its place. It's fun. Yeah. You know.
I just think it's
only getting started.
I don't. Wow. I think it's not.
I hope it's over.
I think it's done. It was fun. Made a lot of money.
$280 million. Did I see that somewhere?
$280 million, 4 days. I think that we've had a year of really good films. Girls Trip made, a record. I mean, all these black films have broke records.
Crystal, that can't just be black people, though. You said earlier that's just black people going to see it.
No. I don't think it's just black people going to see it, but I think
it's definitely just beginning because people don't even know that Storm from the X-Men is Black Panther's wife.
What happens to Nakia?
That'll come out in movies. You so that's how people. I said it's just
Halle Berry Storm or somebody else Storm?
Halle Berry Storm, but it probably not going to be Halle Berry.
Oh, dang.
It's probably going to be somebody
else.
They
can't CGI hologram
see how
Halle Berry is?
Excited about that.
That's probably the next one.
I bet Chadwick would be excited about that. But it's coming in the next Avengers, Black Panther Returns, right?
Oh, really?
If you follow the comics or, whatever, then you'll come across that.
Chances are I'm not going to follow the comics, but if you could just give me a heads up,
I'm still in the pussy,
great.
By the way.
Hey.
I didn't stop liking pussy. Dang.
All right, so in the spirit of, we've been talking about all things Wakanda, right? And yes, be honest. But in the spirit of that, we Kevin and I were talking about the fact that M'Baku mentioned that all his family was vegetarians. So I thought it would be a cool day to bring in Dr. Trey, who I met about, 3 months ago?
Mm-hmm.
She's actually a pharmacist turned chef, healthy chef, assistant to those of us that are moving into a healthier lifestyle. Because we know a lot of times we as African Americans or just people enjoy eating food because of the taste. So Dr. Trey has come up with a line of spices that allow your food to taste flavorful and great without sacrificing taste, but still are delicious. So welcome, Dr. Trey.
Thank you. Thank you guys for having me. I'm super excited to be here. I missed the whole Wakanda.
You haven't been to Wakanda?
I have not. I think I'm going to book a flight tomorrow.
I don't think anybody else has ever been there either.
You must go immediately.
Immediately.
It is a life-changing experience.
Actually, my husband is from Ghana. So he's like, baby, I hope that people don't really think that Wakanda is real. I said, I think people do believe it's real.
It's something that I've been seeing in my head for quite some time.
I doubt that most people can name 10 African countries.
You're right.
I doubt.
You're right.
When I was little, I had to. We had a whole blank map, and you had to put every country in the continent.
You grew up here?
No, I'm from Jersey.
Okay. Okay.
Was that something that, the teachers were doing or your parents were doing that
at
home?
No, they made us do it in class in social studies.
So
they
10 African studies? Countries? Normally, because in my school, they didn't talk about African countries.
Really? No, I didn't. I just, Africa.
I told my wife Africa. Said the same thing today. She said that at her school, they did the exact same thing as she did.
Each continent, you had to name all the countries.
That was in New York, though. But, New York, Jersey is very diverse.
Mm-hmm. It is. And the education is different. There's a different, there's levels to education in different states, so,
Yeah, in Ohio, I was getting Africa, Martin Luther King.
Africa's like a country. It's not a continent. It's a country, right?
Yeah, that was the size of it. So,
yeah. But okay, besides the movie, we're being silly, but besides the movie, there has been a huge shift. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of the documentaries and just information that's been put out over the last year and a half have a lot of people switching to a vegetarian lifestyle, or even if it's not vegetarian, just a healthier way of living. So first of all, from a pharmacist, that seems to be like, I guess they're close, but I just, that's a huge difference in career. So what made you decide to come up with this line of spices?
So I wanted to create something to help people because I became a pharmacist to help people. And my spice line was made with you in mind, people who may not like to cook, people who want to maybe enjoy healthier food, but don't know exactly how to flavor their food. So because I love to cook, I found myself in the kitchen with my counter full of 10 to 12 herbs, spices. I'm grinding cilantro or chopping up cilantro, grinding ginger and doing all these things. And I'm like, this is not something the average person wants to do. Mm-mm. And when I would talk to my friends and I'm like, oh, girl, just do this, X, Y, Z. And they're like, that's just too much. So I started to think like, okay, how can I make this easier for myself and for everybody else? So my husband told me to start writing down. He's like, start writing down everything that you're doing. Write it down. So I started writing it down. And with the help of the Holy Spirit, I just literally just started writing each and every one of the herbs and spices that I was using and what I liked, because I couldn't even use, like, I never used Lawrys, but I would use Tony Saturins because I lived in New Orleans. But I couldn't just use that. So I was like, okay. So why do I like Tony's? Okay, I like a little bit of the heat, but it's too salty. I like this about it, but, you know, so I just started compiling different things and came up with different formulas and came up with my spice line. Now, the first two, the original everything and the Creole Delight, go ahead and take a smell.
Let me see the actual.
And this is the actual bottles.
Okay, so this is the original everything? This is the originator?
Yes. So actually, I started out only with two because this was in 20... Don't hold me to dates. 2016.
That smells great.
It does, right? 2016, I did it for Christmas gifts. And okay. Then in 2017, I met with a marketing branding specialist, and she was like, you have a business. And I'm like, really? I thought it was just, you know, my little thing I was doing. But all of my friends and family just loved it. So those were the first two, the original and the Creole Delight. Now, the Creole Delight, I made that because I told you guys I lived in New Orleans, but I feel like New Orleans food is too spicy for the average person.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. So this has a little mild kick, but your shrimp and grits is going to be on point. Okay. Okay. Your jambalaya is going to be on point with the Creole Delight, and that's all you have to use.
Okay.
Now, what is the... Because all I see, no MSG. No MSG. First, can you explain what that is? Because I know that's a big thing that people... mention as being harmful.
Absolutely. So MSG is monosodium glutamate, and it is a chemical that is used in a lot of seasonings to enhance the flavor. Now, especially in like in other countries, a lot of third world countries, my husband's from Ghana, Africa, a lot of times they use these little Maggie cubes. It's in there. Mm-hmm. But they do that to enhance the flavor and also to preserve the flavor. And then a lot of Asian cuisines have MSG because a lot of the foods that they're using or seasoning, they want to give you that flavor, but they want to not give you as much quality, but they want to preserve it. So it's not really good because it can cause you to have headaches, dizziness, just a lot of different side effects that you don't want. Does it help with the flavor? And another thing you've seen is accent. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you guys have seen that. Mm-hmm. It's called accent. It's a seasoning, and that's all it is. Yeah. So you add it to the rest of your stuff to kind of bring out the flavor, but it's not really necessary because all of the side effects, and it is a chemical. It's unnecessary.
Yeah, it's just tricking your tongue, right? It's not really, you're not really tasting. You're being tricked into believing that you're tasting. Yeah.
Wow.
Yep.
I see here that you have sea salt as opposed to, I guess, the regular salt.
Sea salt is a little bit healthier for your body versus the iodized salt. And that was important to me. I thought about doing pink Himalayan salt, but I was just like, pink Himalayan salt is good. It has a lot more minerals, but sea salt does have a lot of minerals as well that you want in your body.
Okay. You know, is there actually glass in table salt?
I don't know. I haven't heard that.
I don't know where I got that from. Somewhere in my research of, you know, healthy stuff and trying to make that lifestyle change, I picked up that there was like ground up fine glass in table salt. Oh. And that was part of the reason that you needed to switch to sea salt.
Oh my, I never heard that. I'll have to look that up. But that's quite alarming.
Yeah, that's why I was asking if you had heard that as well.
No, I have not. That's a little crazy. If it is, that should be illegal.
Yeah, like you that sounds like we'd have some health issues a long time ago.
I can't
ago.
Imagine what would that, the purpose of that would, like what good they could pull out of that.
Well, like I imagine it to be like a filler, if you will. Supposed to be fine.
Right.
It's supposed to be real fine, so you know, you can it don't cut you or anything, but
Yeah. Well, there's no glass in any of this. I'm
no, 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 no glass.
Maybe you should add that to the no MSG, no gluten, no glass.
And I pride myself on the fact that these is no fillers in here. And the reasoning behind, and this was something I struggled with, but I prayed about it, was, you know, for me, I want to help people. Mm-hmm. And I know a lot of companies, as they grow bigger, they find other ways, like, how can I make more money? How can I make more money? And I never want to sacrifice the quality to make more money. I feel like my blessing will come on another end of it. So for me to make this and fill it just with herbs and spices and nothing else, that's something that I want to continue to do no matter how big Dr. Flava Spices becomes.
Yeah. Awesome. Mm-hmm. Awesome. And that first one, the original everything, as soon as I smell, and I don't want to say Lawrys, mm-hmm. but definitely seasoned salt. Like, I smelled it, and I was like, oh, yeah, this go on some fries, this go on some chicken, this is, yeah.
I didn't think that, actually. I felt like it was a layer above or something. Mm-hmm. It was something else. There was like an after smell. You know how you have an aftertaste? There was like an after smell that was like very alluring.
Yeah.
Well, that's good. And that's another thing. I make sure we use quality herbs and spices so they're not, you know, blended with other things. I tried to make sure I picked a company that looked for the best herbs and spices from all over the world.
Where can we actually get the spices?
So right now, I am strictly online. Right now at this point, we're trying to work on some distribution so more people can know about it, but just and strictly online. And then also, I do have three different spices that are currently at That Burger Spot. It's in Riverdale, Georgia, and they sell some of my spices and they use it on their food that they prepare.
Awesome.
Nice. Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll definitely have to go. But you said That Burger Spot?
That Burger Spot in Riverdale.
In Riverdale, Georgia.
Yes, Riverdale on the south side.
We have to give people the website so they can go and also, do you have some of the recipes on the website as well?
Well, you can always sign up for recipes. I give you some of the ones, the more popular ones. They're not the healthiest ones, but you get a jambalaya pasta. Mm-hmm. You get the chicken salad, the one that you actually tasted, which is
very,
amazing.
Very good. Yes.
So you get that and you get this wonderful kale shrimp salad. You know, and the thing we talked
she
about
looked
this.
At you when she said
she
kale.
Right.
She knew that you're a kale fan. You're a fan of kale.
Fan.
But fan. You know what? The thing is, the reason why people don't eat healthy, and I know this is what we're talking, the reason people don't eat healthy is they don't know how to flavor their food. And so if you can make your kale taste really yummy, I'm sure you would eat it.
I totally agree with you.
That just seems weird that you, that okay, so you're saying that meat doesn't need to be flavored?
I'm saying that,
is that
anything,
what you guys are saying?
No, I'm saying anything you eat needs to be flavored.
Right, but okay.
If it's not, especially black folks.
Oh, I
folks,
see,
you know
I see where you're
are.
Going.
If it's not
I see
flavored
the trap
properly,
he's laying.
Why would you call
properly,
that a trap?
It ain't, we don't want it.
He's pulling you in.
I'm not pulling anyone in. I'm just saying that I feel like all food needs to be seasoned. And I'm a person who doesn't eat a lot of condiments. I don't eat a lot of things. So mm-hmm. I need whatever I'm eating to taste kind of good on its own. However, I'm not afraid of spices. I'm not, and that original everything is something that I'm definitely looking forward to purchasing.
Yeah, you have to definitely try it. But I would definitely say this. Everything should be flavored. But the one thing, especially in our community, African-American community, we think that flavor entails us using a lot of salt. Mm-hmm. And we have to use
right,
certain
grease.
Meat, yeah, grease and certain meat products to enhance the flavor. I make
pork.
Amazing collard greens, okay? And I don't put meat in there. I've used the original and the Creole and onions and bell peppers. Yummy. Very, very.
Wow.
And a little apple cider vinegar and a little hit of honey just to balance it.
So you don't eat any meat at all, ever?
No, I do eat meat. Oh, okay. I never said I didn't eat meat, but I can show you how to eat food that does not have meat.
Gotcha.
And I found that you don't have to eat meat at every meal.
Right.
I grew up that way. A lot of us, I grew up, you eat a meat
with a side
a
of meat.
Vegetable and a starch, like
yeah.
a meat, vegetable, starch. That was
right.
the norm. I had a chance to go to Ghana. And when you look at how they eat,
mm-hmm.
meat is very small. You do it for celebratory reasons, for weddings,
mm-hmm.
things like that. You eat more of the starches, you know, and then you eat very little bit of meat. And so me and my husband, sometimes when he used to cook for me, I'm like, baby, I need some more beef. Why you only gave me those little tiny little pieces? And
right.
he's like, okay. But then I learned that you don't need all of that. It's just something that the way I grew up, but it's not good for you.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I was saying that I'm trying to start, because I think that it becomes like, if you go according to every fad, then you'll be crazy, right?
Yes.
So for me, the older I get, I'm like, okay, meat is not something I need all the time. I'm not really ready to cut it out all the way.
Right.
But I'm getting my diets where I eat less of it. And then I realize I'm not relying on certain things. So I was relying on meat and starches.
Right.
And those, and neither one of those are healthy for you to eat on a daily basis. Right. So just trying to kind of create a better, a more balanced,
more conscious
system for myself, right? And I think everybody's body is different, you know?
Right.
My boyfriend, he is like, I'm not cutting out meat. Like, I need meat to fill what
I...
Yeah, so that's... And that's fine, but I think just eating different types of meat and also just being more conscious of what you're putting in your body.
Right, you absolutely. Know? And I agree with you because you don't... I think a lot of people saw what the health...
Saw that.
When I saw that, I was like, I'm not eating any meat. I'm not doing this. I got all crazy. And,
sorry,
my husband watched it and he was totally floored and he wasn't eating meat for like 2 days. It was 2 days. I held out for a month and then I was like, gosh, I'm feeling hungry. But what I found out is you have to eat more. If you're doing plant-based, you have to eat more food.
Large
to
quantities.
To feel full. Yeah. And I found myself that... I was still eating like regular portions, so I was like, I didn't feel satisfied. And
you're looking
thing.
For the meat. You're
right.
Like, I'm supposed to have a piece of meat right here, right. So I'm just eating around the meat as opposed to
exactly.
that. Yeah,
but I don't knock it. I mean, I have a lot of vegan friends. Mm. I just believe in being more conscious, more aware,
right,
and just understand that you can have other options like lentils. They are full of fiber and protein, and I make some really good lentils. Like people when they eat them, like, oh my gosh, they taste so good. Like really, really, really good. So it's just about learning and having other options. That's all. So what do you eat?
Yeah. Well, I as far as like a meat replacement, mushrooms.
What kind?
A lot of mushrooms, shiitake mushrooms, or even whole mushrooms.
Portobello, no?
Portobello, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll eat portobello. Quinoa. A lot of quinoa. Some kamut. When I can find it, kamut's a little more difficult to find, but I like kamut.
Okay. Extra healthy, right?
I told you. He's our healthy guy.
But you know,
mushroom is lastly honest, too. It's like,
In terms of meat replacement, mushrooms, I've gotten pizza from Fellini's. And like their veggie pizza.
I've had that. It's pretty good.
That mushroom make you think it's meat. It's that good. Like, and so you try to find little things that are good. Because I still like food. I never stopped liking food just because I wanted to eat healthy.
You just like tasting it.
But I had to find things that were good for me that I still enjoyed eating. And when I found those things that were healthier, it was more enjoyable because they tasted good.
Right.
And it was easier for me to eat large quantities of it.
Awesome.
Well, we want to thank Dr. Trey for stopping by today. Let's let everyone know your website again and then how they can find you on social media as well.
So I keep it real simple. I'm at Dr. Dr. Flava, F-L-A-V-A, and it's Flava Spices on all social media. And it's the same thing, drflavorspices.com, where you can find us, you can purchase us, and we're having an amazing sale. And I just want people to eat healthier, be more conscious, and understand that you can do this thing. You can live a longer, healthier life if we just think about what we're putting in our bodies.
That's awesome. Great to know. So how many spices are available right now? Let's run down each of the ones that they can find.
So I actually have 8 total. I don't have them all because I sold out of a couple.
Oh, wow.
But I actually have 8, 2 alkaline-based for my alkaline vegans. That's a real popular
Kevin
movement.
That's
Dr.
Kevin.
Sabi followers. So I made that line for them. And then I have, of course, the original and the Creole Delight. That's going to give you that more soulful flavor. Replace your Lawrys, your Tonys. Garlic, ginger, lime, do not sleep on it, but that'll give you a more Asian flair.
Okay.
It's really, really yummy. The Southwest, replace your taco packets. Then, like I said, I have my alkaline, lime herb, and island twist. And then I have a spicy Cajun twist and a Creole lemon pepper.
Oh, that sounds really good. Yeah. Creole lemon pepper sounds really good.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and it's no fake yellow dye, which is totally unnecessary.
Oh, I didn't even know that there was fake yellow dye in the first one. But
there is.
See?
Yes. Yeah. What's your favorite dish to make? Before we let you go, what's your favorite dish right now?
It is, wow. You know, I already
especially
told
if you're trying to lead a healthier life.
Yeah, that's like...
What?
Salmon. What's your cheat code? On salmon. Mm-hmm. Salmon is so freaking good.
I agree.
Yeah, and I cook it with grapeseed oil. I saw someone cooking it today. I was like, oh, this is how you cook. And they had all this butter. And I'm like, oh my gosh, it already has enough oil because it has a lot of omega 3. So salmon is a big one. I like to eat it with sweet potatoes, I make them savory like I made it at the Rolling Out. Mm-hmm. So yummy. So you make them savory and that's still your good starch and it's still going to be filling. Mm-hmm. And then I like to eat that with either some collard greens or I can eat it with cabbage, either or.
So that sounds delicious. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Yeah.
And it's like all quick to cook.
Yeah.
We'll have to talk about that later. Like, how quick is that? I actually had roasted sweet potatoes for the first time, and they were really, really good.
Yeah, it's good. Mm-hmm. Anything roasted, and mm-hmm. I know we're about to leave, but I actually did a whole series on the cookie sheet life, and that's all for that busy woman who wants to cook healthier food, but you cook mm-hmm. it all on a sheet.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah, and it cooks in like 30 minutes. Cut you up some potatoes, but you have to cut them up small enough. Mm-hmm. And you can cook that along with your vegetables all on one sheet. You don't want to cook it with the salmon because the salmon doesn't need to cook as long.
Okay.
So you would separate it. But
now, is this on your website?
It's on my Facebook and then my YouTube.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And I'm Dr. Flava Spices everywhere.
Sounds good. So Dr. Flava, and that's F-L-A-V-A mm-hmm. Spices. Look her up. If you guys have any questions for her, please send them to us and we're happy to share them to share them with Dr. Trey as well. So thank you for coming and sharing this. I know Kevin's been waiting. You know, he applauds anyone that's eating healthy like
absolutely.
Himself.
I'm actually a little upset we ain't got no food right now. I'm like, we got all these spices.
We don't have any food to try.
I
ain't
got nothing to shake it on.
I have to bring some next time.
I need to shake something.
I got some paper. It's just like quinoa. It's just like kale. You're like, what the hell?
I'm with him on the quinoa because I think quinoa takes on the taste of whatever it's with. Like, mm-hmm. it's just like a filler, right?
It makes you want to call it quinoa.
Well, it's like rice. It's like rice. But you got to, if you season it right,
I make some killer quinoa. And sometimes I put beans in there, like beans and rice.
Yeah, we need something.
And I just make quinoa and beans, and it's like really, really good.
You know what? It's funny because my lady's Jamaican too, and she makes beans and rice all the time. And I was like, yo, babe, what if we did beans and red beans and quinoa? She was like,
no, it tastes really good.
You're doing too much.
It tastes so, I'm telling you, it's really, really good. I've surprised a lot of people. Quinoa and beans. I call it like rice and beans. It's really good.
Okay. Ooh. Well, yeah, you got a co-sign
on it.
Yummy. Yummy.
Thank you, Dr. Trey.
Thank you.
And we'll definitely keep in touch, especially like I said, if we have any questions from viewers, and we'll definitely have to check out the spices and report back.
Right.
Thank you so much. Mm-hmm.
Oh my God, we mentioned it a little bit earlier, but if you have not watched Chris Rock's special on Netflix called Tambourine, you have to watch it. Chris Rock, to me, is the king of intelligent comedy. Like, I know that everyone is...
High school dropout Chris Rock is the king of intelligence comedy.
He is. He's
political satire.
Yeah, he's the best. He gets it.
I think that philosophically, me and him agree on a lot of things. He might listen to our other show. Because he made some points that I've made.
Like what? Give me a couple.
I can't think right now, but... I'll remember in a second.
He made a lot of good. I mean, his idea.
So Chris Rock stealing your jokes?
Yes, everybody kid is not a superstar. Like for real, said that.
Yeah, he said there was a few Uber. He said about 60 Uber drivers.
I'm willing to go a step further. That counselor in high school that told you, "Hey, don't apply to that college. You need to look at this vocational school." That motherfucker's right too. Tell these kids because somebody needs to tell them. Get a trade, son. Go be a mechanic. You know, you're not really cut out for a lawyer. Architect, ain't, you know, that's not going to happen.
This is what I wonder, because I taught school for one dreadful year.
It actually was legit, though, but I won't.
But I wonder, like, does the kid who really is more suited to be a mechanic, does he have aspirations of being a lawyer, or do his parents want him to? Because most kids...
don't have a fucking clue what they want to do.
No. Some of them do. Some of them do, but most kids who are not that bright are not looking towards careers that are super bright. It's their parents like, you can do it. You can be this. And the kid is like, oh, shit. I don't want to disappoint. What the
fuck? But do you know how many kids went to college because that's what their parents said they
most
had to do?
Them.
Because
yeah.
their parents wanted to brag about having a kid in college.
Well, I would I say know most.
Parents right? want to brag.
Absolutely that's... they did.
No.
But you
no.
know what? Let's just be real about it. There are a lot of trade jobs that right. pay very well.
There are.
And they didn't get filled because kids were going to college.
They didn't get filled?
And a
filled?
lot of those kids, yes, there's a lot of trade jobs that are open right now. There's a shortage of trade jobs in the economy. We need more tradespeople. They're telling people, they're pushing people, go pick up a trade.
On the real, if you're not doing IT, that's all America has. We don't have any. It's all trades.
Plumber.
It's all service.
Carpenter, mechanic.
Those are good jobs, and usually,
and there's nothing wrong with that. But we sold people the idea that those jobs, those blue collar jobs, were lower class.
I don't think we sold.
And that everyone needs to be a doctor or a lawyer.
I don't think we sold people that. Let's don't just skip over the fact
it
that
it became racism people want, to tell a kid to go.
People
to do
want
that.
Their children to do better than them. And
like,
at some
he was
point,
just saying a moment ago,
at some point, those jobs were all we were able to do. And so I think there's a plumber that said, down there in the doo-doo water, said, I don't want my son to have to do this. My son is good enough to put on a suit and go to work at IBM. I want him to know that he can do that too. There's nothing wrong with that. Now, no, I'm just saying the idea that that's all we were able to do at one point. But I think now we're realizing that, hey, there's nothing wrong with being down there in the doo-doo water, because he's going to always have a job. Where getting suited up for IBM, he may get fired. If he's got a trade, he can open his own business. He can, he always has something he can do to make money. He or she. I'm not trying to be gender biased. But I think that people were not trying to brag about the fact that their children went to college. I think that people wanted a better life for their children. Any parent wants their child to do better than them. That's not about bragging. It's just about saying, man, I've had to struggle. I don't want the same struggle for my child.
There's, I'm just saying in terms of the perception, if a guidance counselor told you 4-year college, not so much, you need to pick up a trade. If you as a parent, if the guidance counselor told you that about your child, would you be offended?
Yes.
Or would you be,
it depends on
would
who
you
tells
look
me
at
that.
It like, you know what, maybe there's something to this.
It depends on who tells you that, because I don't trust a person that automatically sees my black son as a trade worker to tell me that. Now, if it's someone who knew my child and said your child, because of your child's test scores and their aptitude test scores, I believe that's different. But
that's their job though, right? Isn't that what a counselor's job is?
But that's not what a lot of counselors are doing. There are a lot of students that have been told that they weren't going to be successful based on the fact that they were black and grew up poor. So, I mean, I think you have to consider the source. And I think that if people were actually testing children and working with children, which no one has time to do that. A counselor doesn't have time to do that with every kid in their school.
You got to use generalizations.
You got to use generalizations.
I don't know that there's a standardized test that's literally going to tell you if you're going to be a white collar or a blue collar type of.
They're not, but there are tests that you can take. At the school that I went to, we took a lot of tests to tell us what we were good at. Right? What skill set you were, I am horrible at math, and this test proved that. I'm horrible at math. I'm horrible at science. So I knew, and I went to a school that prepped us for college, right? So I knew that I wanted to be a veterinarian, that math and science was not going to be easy for me to do. Not saying I couldn't do it,
so,
but that wasn't
wait a minute,
easy
so
for
you,
me to do.
The way it looked for you was veterinarian. That's what you were.
No, what it showed for me is that I needed to do something with communications, which is why it was easy for me to pick public relations, because I'm good at those things. I'm good at communicating, I'm good at writing, good at speaking. I wasn't good at math and science. So I'm not saying that I don't think that I shouldn't. If someone should have told me, no, Crystal, you can't be a veterinarian, but I think that someone could have said, which my counselors did, look at a career in this field because this is what you excel at. And this is what's going to come natural to you, writing and communicating. And it did. It was right for me.
But what he's saying is, all that being said, what if they had told you, I don't know if any of those are good fields for you. Maybe
you need to do hair.
Yeah, maybe you should go to cosmetology.
But I mean, would that have been, but they told me that based on my test scores.
Right.
What my test scores are said I was.
What if they were so low that they said, let's find something that's maybe a little, do you like doing hair?
I think that's great. I think that would have been good. I think there are some people that are not, that learn differently. That's what I learned teaching school. I taught for a charter school for African-American students under a lady that was very, she was ahead of her time as far as understanding that black children learn differently, right? So you have to realize what I learned in that short period of time is every child, we put kids at a school, there's damn near 30 kids in every classroom. All those kids learn differently. You know, so for a little boy that it, my son is a good example of a kid that is made to go to college. He's very book smart. You know, he excels at that. So he's at a school where he's ended up teaching a class and he knows he wants to be a writer, but his skill set lends towards that. My daughter is the opposite. She's not a person that just likes to spend. My son took 18 hours. To him, that was easy. My daughter's like, she doesn't have the attention span to do that. So she's at a school that supports, she's at AIU now. So that supports, you know, her skill set, which is she's more hands-on. Yeah. You got to know your kid. You know what I mean? I wouldn't have put if my son was at AIU where they're, you know, hands-on, the classes are shorter. Another good school, Full Sail, great school for kids that learn differently. A great school. If my son was at Full Sail, he would fail. He would do horribly there because that's not for him. As a parent, I think you have to be more proactive in learning your child because I wouldn't let a guidance counselor tell my child something that I didn't know. You have to know your child.
Okay, I agree. I wasn't trying to say that they should pick better than you. I think what Chris Rock was saying, what I'm saying is that every kid cannot be anything they want.
Every kid
can't be president. Every kid can't be a dog. You know what I'm saying? And that's the thing I think philosophically we definitely match up on. It's just but overall though, I think that what was great about Chris Rock's special was that he was very like he got the white stuff out of the way quick. Did you notice that?
I didn't even have a chance to say hello. He just went right into it with police shootings.
White people ain't shit. Like y'all still whitey. But now let's get to these jokes. Like I think that that's what's really cool about him is that even though he's kind of somebody who's past the threshold of ever being poor in his life ever again, he still is willing to jump right back down on the front of the stage and throw his feet off the edge and look at a white person in their face and like, you're still whitey.
He was like, I'm like, nigga. It's about 4 feet close to me. Oh, it's Chris Rock. Like I'm not rich from far away. I'm not famous from far away. Right. Another thing that he said that I know you would agree with, we talked about the porn. He mentioned that porn had desensitized him to. He said it gave him sexual autism, which I thought was extremely brilliant.
That's
right?
True,
sexual.
Man.
It created sexual autism, and then he had to get himself back under control.
That's true. So in context, how do you guys stack that against Dave Chappelle's specials?
I know people are going to.
Did
do
you see
that.
Chris Rock yet?
I haven't seen Chris Rock yet.
Okay,
but Kevin's partial.
But he hasn't seen it yet.
But you know what? And Dave Chappelle and Chris Rock, they have been doing a lot more stuff together. So I'm loving seeing the two of them
because it's both intelligent. Together. It's intelligent comedy. Yeah. But I think for me, I think Chris Rock's is hands down the best. But I'm more of a Chris Rock fan. I think that. Dave Chappelle does a little bit of both where he'll give you some mindless kicked her in the pussy, you know, funny stuff. Mm. But Chris Rock is going to make you think like long after you. And I wrote an article about that. Long after you turn the special off, you're sitting there thinking about some of the things that he said. And, you know, he's just for me, that's the bigger choice.
So, you know, there's been a lot of criticism also from people like Faison Love. Mm-hmm. Have you guys seen that?
Oh, about
Dave Chappelle.
Yeah.
I think that we've entered a new era of comedy.
Mm-hmm.
Comedy is no longer slapstick fall down.
Right.
Here's the punchline. Everybody laugh at the same time.
Right. Right.
Comedy has become more introspective. And mm-hmm. I think that it's not necessarily hilarious anymore. Now comedy is a little bit of pain too. And
I don't know. That's a good point because I don't know if it ever was not. Because, you know, people made a big deal about Quincy Jones' statements about, you know, talking about Richard Pryor being bisexual. And actually, if you watch a Richard Pryor special, Richard Pryor had a lot of pain and he found a way to make fun of his pain. And some of it you weren't sure if you should laugh at or like
he was way ahead
was
of his time,
out of control. Yeah. And even, I mean, I think the best comedians are people who take their life and are able to make fun of, but there's a lot of pain behind that. You know what I mean? That's their way of dealing with it. And I think that's what makes them who they are. And I read an article about comedians being very dark and sometimes depressed people. And I know Martin Lawrence has talked about that, dealing with depression because
Robin Williams,
you know, killed himself. And he had some very dark, you know, moments that he talked about publicly, but yet he was one of the funniest comedians, you know, that we've seen. So I think that comedy has always had a darkness to it.
Yeah.
You know, we don't see that from every comedian, but I think the best ones are able to let us in on that. And you kind of learn a little bit and you laugh and you learn a little bit and you laugh.
But you know what I think is as a human being, if you are really being honest with yourself, you have to have a sense of humor because it softens the blow when you got to get real about your shit, right?
Yeah.
Everybody's coping mechanism is different.
Right. But at the same time, after the joke wears off, you're still left with the reality of what it is.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And some of it is gruesome. Some of it is very dark.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I mean, we can talk about a lot of the sophomoric stuff that Dave Chappelle has done. It's, you know, kind of ha-ha.
Mm-hmm.
But the third special that he did, I can't
Bird,
remember what it was called
the
right
Bird
now.
Bird one? The one where he was sitting on the bench? I mean, on the stool?
Yeah. He was in the... It was a lot dark.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It was a lot dark. It was a lot more dark and intimate.
He started
it was in
off,
a small room.
Yeah. Yep.
And he's kind of talked a little bit more about what was going on between he and Comedy Central.
Mm-hmm.
And what that relationship...
Lots of blimos
show
in there.
Business was.
Yeah.
A ton of that dark stuff.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And you know what? Let me say this as well. I've never seen Faison Love do stand-up.
I have. He's funny.
He seems funny.
I've never seen him.
He's funny. He's a funny guy.
I've never seen him do stand-up.
I don't think it matters that Dave Chappelle wasn't a quote-unquote black comedian. I don't think that matters. Mm-hmm. I think Dave Chappelle is hilarious.
Yeah, I think he's just a comedian.
And I'm not sure if this is a attention get.
I think it was.
He's a very strange fellow.
He's funny, though. Faison Love is funny. His acting roles have been like, you know, some of them have been big worms.
See, I've never seen him do stand-up.
I've seen him do stand-up. He's funny.
Yeah,
he's still big worm.
Yeah, but that's not his fault. Yeah. But he's funny too. I just think
it's not his fault.
Because he didn't know that role was going to typecast him. Yeah, that role was going to be like how everybody saw him for the rest of his life. Like,
yeah, but I didn't see him trying to be in Black Panther either.
Yeah, but would they
We don't know
in Black
what
Panther?
He was trying to do though. Yeah. He might not have been. I mean, I don't think he would have fit whereas a fat Wakandan.
I think he's on the road.
I think there's all vegetarians.
You think they're very healthy. You think Faison Love could have been M'Baku?
I don't think so.
No, that's not what we wanted from M'Baku. Because he would have fell on the ground, his stomach would have rolled off to the side, like, nah. But no, I think he's funny too, but I think that there's
Are you done?
There's a new era of comedy, and I think that it's everyone now is doing what Richard Pryor was doing all those years ago, where you let out a little pain. Martin Lawrence did it on Run Tell That.
Mm-hmm.
You let out some of the pain, where he was talking about he was running down the street, you know what I'm saying, that time when he lost
his
mind.
He made fun of his situation.
They're letting the pain out as a little bit with the comedy, too. And I think it's not just, hey, come down and sit and laugh. It's, hey, come sit and think, and you're going to laugh along the way.
I think they're good comics have always done that though.
They are great storytellers.
But I was going to say I went for Valentine's Day. I went to see a comedy show with T.K. Kirkland, and I didn't realize. So I'm sitting there laughing, and he's very funny, but he's like swole. And I was like, this guy looks like he just got out of jail.
Right.
I didn't realize that he actually had been to jail, and that is his story. So when I was listening to his
credit card stuff,
he is very. In your face, he has that New York swagger, and it does make you feel like he's very upfront and aggressive with the audience, and you think, is he serious?
You liked him? He hates women.
Does he?
I think so.
I didn't get that. He was funny. He was really
funny. He's funny, though. But
yeah,
I don't think women liked
him. He was very aggressive with the audience, though.
Right.
He was like, sit down. You know, I didn't tell you to get up yet. And I was like, is he just joking?
No.
I don't know. But the point is, people had really, I think who you are, that's one of the jobs that the intimacy of you and the audience, you get a good snapshot into who that person, at least one perspective of who that person is. You know, and when a person does it and they do it really well, I think they do. They let you. They show vulnerability.
Yeah.
You know, that's a sign of a great comedian. Watch Tambourine. He's amazing.
Tambourine was good.
Yeah. Cool beans. We good with Wakanda?
Yeah.
Wakanda.
Well, you know what? I think my last thing. Okay, don't be surprised when black people say colonizer a lot more.
Oh my God, I really hope not.
That's coming. It's here.
It's going to be on Instagram for
it's
a while,
here now.
But Jesus Christ.
Silence colonizer. It's coming, yo. Brilliant.
All right. Can we call
Beyonce
that?
No, we cannot call Beyonce colonizer.
Are you half colonizer?
No. Who am I colonizing?
I just tried it. Yeah. I tried it. If you guys, please send us. It would be great to see your pictures from Wakanda, if you dressed up as one of the characters, we would love to put those on our website. I'll have to send mine in and my video if we walk in on the rose petals.
Can't
I am excited about
I'm going again.
I've been twice.
And you know, I sent a video too because people said they were going three and four times, or they're going to go once a week until it's out of the theaters.
No, I'm good. I think I'm good, but I may.
I'm a Fire Stick it. I paid. You know how much I paid?
It's not the same quality.
Bullshit. You know how much I paid?
It's on Fire Stick now, but it's
we
not
the
same.
We are striking that. It will.
No, I'm going to Fire Stick. It'll be HD in about a couple of weeks. You know how much it cost me to go to the movies to see motherfucking Black Panther?
Yeah, I know. We all
I think we spent like $45.
Yeah, we all paid it. And I went in 3D.
I didn't see it wasn't even 3D. I had to sit in the recliner.
You spent a good 50.
I don't go to the regular theater no more. I have to go to the recliner seats where it's like space. I can't do it.
Well, that's you. You're bougie with your movie watching.
Studio Movie Grill or something.
I'm too rich for general admission. I can't do it anymore.
Y'all send us your pictures so we can post them on the Facebook page and Kevin can rule on who is the most authentic
Wakandan?
Wakandan.
Yes.
We'll see you guys next week.
Music Love Life.